A rejection region, well, that's the range of values in which the null hypothesis is not probable. It's out to the far right or to the far left on that normal curve, and it could be on both if it's a two-tailed test. It's always in the direction of the alternative hypothesis. It's equal to the alpha level. So, for example, on the Excel sheet here, looking at this two-tailed test here, there are two rejection regions, and we got into this in the last video, here and here. That these two areas in red, if you add them together, that adds up to this area right here, 0.05. That's your probability, 5% chance that it could be up in here or down in there. So it's really like a 2.5% chance here on the right and a 2.5% chance on the left right here. Now, on a right tail test, your rejection region is all on the right hand side. That's this area in the red, and I'll tell you what this black line here means in a little bit, but that would be all this area here in the red. That would be your rejection region. It's on the right-hand side. And notice this area here is actually bigger than this area right here. Why? Because on a two-tailed test, it splits the alpha in two, and you get half of your 0.05 here, or whatever your alpha is. On this particular example, your alpha level is 0.05. So half of it's here, 2.5% here, 2.5% here. On a one-tailed test, whether it be right or left, all your alpha is on one side. So you can see that this one, it goes clear down here to about 1.64. About 1.645 right here, whereas this one only goes down to 1.96. That's because it goes down to 1.96 and up to negative 1.96. So, and then on a left-tailed test, your rejection region's all on the left-hand side over here. Okay, so there's more rejection region on one side on these one-tailed tests, and on the two-tailed test, it splits the alpha in two to give you two rejection regions. All right. So that's your rejection regions, and then the number that separates the rejection region from the non-rejection region is called the critical value. Okay, the critical value is where your rejection region starts, and if we look at that, see, you have two critical values here, plus and minus 1.96, because you have positive 1.96 where the red starts, the rejection region starts, and negative 1.96 where the rejection region starts. This one-tailed test only have one critical value, 1.645 approximately. That's right here. See, that's where the rejection region started. And on a right-tailed test, your rejection region is always going to be on the right-hand side. On a left-tailed test, your rejection region is always going to be on the left, and in this one, we had a 0.05 alpha level with a large sample size, a sample size of 30 or more, that you get this z-score right here of negative 1.64. So it's this value, negative 1.64, is your critical value. Okay. And then finally, the test statistic. Well, the test statistic is where you use all your sample data to switch it over to a standard score, such as a z-score or a t-score, so that you can compare your test statistic to your critical value to see if your sample data, which gives you your z or t-score or some other formula later, is far enough into the rejection region that you can reject the null hypothesis with that high level of confidence, you know, or a small alpha level, a low probability of making the wrong decision. So you use one of these formulas to give you the test statistics. Now that's what you would do if you did it by hand, but Excel works that out for you, the test statistic, and you can see with some of these, like this one, test statistic of 89, that's kind of ridiculous here. I just didn't change any numbers here. But that's off the scale on this. But here's one we're going to do here in a little bit. And here's the test statistic. The test statistic is in black right here. Okay, so that's this point. If this would be far enough away from the claim, then you would reject the null hypothesis. Now, how far away does it have to be? It has to be in one of these tails, because these tails only have that low probability of being in there. How low? That's your alpha level. Okay, so if the test statistic lands in the rejection region, you reject it. Okay, so let's go ahead and do a couple problems here. I think we're about ready. And you would use the 1mu sheet for both these two sections, 7.2 and 7.3. And on this problem, it says a cereal company claims that the mean sodium content in one serving of cereal is no more than 230 milligrams. Okay, this comes from the last section there where you got to realize no more than means what? less than or equal to. No more than 230, less than or equal to 230. You work for a National Health Service and you are asked to test this claim. Okay, so we're going to test this claim that it's no more, that it's less than or equal to 230. What does that make the alternate? That it's greater than 230. Okay, well, we don't want that much sodium in our cereal. I mean, that can cause high blood pressure and so on. So your right tail test here is that mu is greater than 230 because your alternate, sorry, your null was that it was less than or equal to because it says no more than, less than or equal to, making your alternate a greater than, and this would be a right tail test. So that I know where I need to go now to do this problem. And then you sample 52, so we're dealing with a large sample there. It's greater than 30 and has a mean sodium content of 232. So this is your sample mean, okay? So your X bar is 232. Here's your claimed mu, 230. Here's your sample size of 52, and it has a standard deviation of 10. And it says at the alpha level of 0.05, do you have enough evidence to reject the company's claim? Well, let's see. This, we're going to be doing a right tail test. It's on the mean, so we're on the one mu sheet. A right tail test, that's right here. We put in our alpha level of 0.05. We put in the claimed mean of 230. We put in what our sample mean was, which was 232, so that's slightly above. But is this enough higher than 230 to reject it? Well, it depends on a lot of things. It depends on your sample size, for one thing. The higher your sample is, the more likely you are to reject the null hypothesis with a value that's close to the null hypothesis. And then also it depends on the standard deviation. A smaller standard deviation makes it more likely to reject the null hypothesis. So we got all of our information in there, the sample size, standard deviation, the sample mean, the claim mean, and the alpha level. Now, automatically, it calculates the test statistic here. It calculates it by just going through that z-score. It did x bar minus mu times the square root of n over your standard deviation, and it gets this. So now it switched all this stuff over to a standard z-score of 1.4422. Okay, that's your test statistic. This is the critical value. This is how far out that test statistic would have had to be for you to reject it. Well, your test statistic is not greater than that critical value there, so it's not going to land in your rejection region. So, and you can see that down here. Here is your test statistic of 1.422. That's drawn in that black line right there. So here's 1.4. 1.422 is just a tad bit above 1.4. But your rejection region doesn't start until 1.649 or so right here. So since that test statistic did not fall in that rejection region, then that 232 right here is not enough higher than that 230 for us to make the inference to all the boxes of cereal for this one type of cereal. Okay, this is just 52 servings of cereal. Can we say that 232 is significantly greater than 230? No, we can't, because we didn't reject the null hypothesis. Okay, it's amazing that sometimes just a little bit bigger of a number will cause that to be significantly, that we would be able to reject the null hypothesis. But in this one, we can't reject the null hypothesis. So we are unable, we do not reject the null hypothesis. And then the summary is always in terms of the alternate hypothesis. So if you don't reject the null hypothesis, that means you are unable to show the alternate. Okay? If you do not reject the null, you are unable to show the alternate. Okay? If you do reject the null, you reject the null, then you are able to show the alternate. Okay, well, we did not, right here it tells you, we did not reject the null hypothesis, so we are unable to show this. So we would summarize this by saying at this alpha level, at the 0.05 alpha level, we are unable to show that the average sodium content in this brand of cereal is significantly greater than 230 milligrams. Okay, even though our sample mean was a little bit bigger than 232, it's not statistically significantly greater than 230 milligrams per bowl of cereal. So again, at the 0.05 alpha level, we were unable to show that the average sodium content is, we were again unable to show that the average sodium content was significantly greater than 230. Unable to show that. Okay, so we are not able to reject the company's claim that their sodium content is 230.